One day in 1954, while she was serving her three-day term as county judge pro tem, a white man saw her walking down the hall. As she passed, he said, in a voice loud enough to be easily heard, "What the hell is this place coming to? We got a nigger judge now?" Charlie continued to walk along until she reached the white drinking fountain. There, she stopped, took a drink, turned and smiled at her antagonist, and continued her walk down the hall.
Charlie O. Farris's life was marked by her ability to overcome the various challenges life presented. From her childhood in Wichita Falls to her undergraduate years at A&M Prairie View University, and finally to her years in law school at Howard University, Charlie encountered numerous challenges as a female, more specifically, as a black female. Her legal career was no different. When Charlie passed her bar exam, becoming the first black female lawyer in the state of Texas, the local paper in Wichita Falls refused to print her picture in their paper because she was black. However, against all the odds she faced as a black woman in a predominantly white Wichita Falls, she gained the love and support from her community because of her unwavering commitment to justice and her infallible work ethic. On July 7, 1954, Charlie was chosen to serve as County Judge Pro Tem in the absence of Judge Guy H. McNeely. This was the first time that a black person had served as a judge in any capacity in the South since the Reconstruction. Her selection as County Judge Pro Tem came as a shock to many and resonated around the nation. Newspapers, from the Washington Post to the New York Times, called for pictures and interviews. This, in their eyes, was a moment that had the potential to create a platform in the fight against racial and social injustice in the South, and one that could prove to be very historic. However, the situation at home was far different. The local paper, the Wichita Falls Times, once again refused to print a picture of Charlie in their papers and instead simply wrote a brief article about her. The Times publisher, Rhea Howard, refused to print pictures of black people for any reason, no matter the circumstances. Being a Wichita Falls native, Charlie was upset by the paper's lack of consideration for her achievements based on the fact that she was black. In her mind, this was unfair, but, as was her habit, she made no complaints. However, she vowed that she would never allow her picture to be printed in the Wichita Falls Times as long as Howard was in charge. The racial discrimination present inside the courthouse was no different than it was outside. Black people were not permitted to use the white restrooms on various floors within the building, and instead had to use restrooms in the basement of the courthouse. There were also separate drinking fountains for blacks and whites. Although Charlie felt uncomfortable with the glaring injustice, she never complained. Instead, she continued to work hard and impress community members with her legal skills. Not only did Charlie face difficulties in the courthouse and in her practice because she was black, but she was often excluded from her local bar association because of her race and gender. The same group of lawyers who had helped nominate her for the county judge pro tem position, led by Jimmy Castledean and Graham Purcell Jr., had trouble admitting her to the Wichita County Bar Association. There was bitterness among the local legal practitioners towards Charlie. If not for the few lawyers who fought alongside Charlie for her rights, she might not have been admitted to the local bar. And even though the bar members eventually relented, Charlie's admission was in vain. The Bar Association's meetings were usually held in the Marchman Hotel, which refused to serve black people at the time, rendering Charlie unable to attend meetings. Prior to the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, tension between blacks and whites continued to rise. White police officers and city officials around the nation used police dogs, namely German Shepherds, to disperse peaceful protesters fighting for equal rights. On numerous occasions, dogs were known to have attacked protesters where people were injured or killed. Throughout Charlie's career, the case that stood out the most and held special significance to her was the case of Frank and Marilyn Bellowin versus Willard and Sarah Boyd et al. In 1960, Jack Davis, the new city manager of Wichita Falls, decided they needed police dogs for the protection of officers and to help track criminals. Officer Boyd, who lived in the same neighborhood as Charlie, was given a dog to care for and bring into work every day. Charlie was outraged by the presence of police dogs in her neighborhood for what they symbolized. There had been instances where the dog was allowed to run free and had attacked community members. Because Charlie couldn't sue the city herself, she convinced her friends and neighbors, Frank and Marilyn Billowin, to hire her to do so on their behalf to get rid of the dog. Charlie argued that by keeping a dog in the Boyd's house, they violated some of the restrictive covenants in the neighborhood, and concluded her argument by assuring the court that the plaintiff sought no monetary damages, but rather were seeking a court order requiring the defendants to remove the dog and its house from the neighborhood. She won, and both the dog and doghouse were removed.
Given that Charlie was the first black female lawyer in Texas, prospective clients were put off by the potential disadvantages of hiring Charlie. There was concern that as a female lawyer in a male-dominated profession, her representing clients would not be favorable in the eyes of the judges, even if she had a stronger argument. The greater concern stemmed from Charlie being black. Since juries were almost exclusively white males, people worried about Charlie's ability to overcome the racial discrimination that was so pervasive in the courts of Wichita Falls. Knowing that there may be some resentment towards Charlie representing clients, she often began by addressing the jurors, saying, "You may resent me because I am black, and you may resent me because I am a woman, but please remember that our legal system requires that you make your decision based on the facts." Charlie didn't always win, but every client, regardless of race or age, received her best efforts to help them win. Despite the adversity, over the course of time, Charlie's practice began to grow rapidly. The Civil Rights Act was passed in 1964 after President Kennedy's assassination. The act outlawed discrimination based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. The act gave the Attorney General the authority to file suits against any school district that did not enforce the act. It prohibited any municipal or state government from prohibiting entrance into public facilities. Upon hearing the news of the act's passage, Charlie moved to an office right across from the courthouse. The previous office she had was in the part of town designated for blacks. This decision signified the beginning of a new era in Wichita Falls. Charlie wanted to let it be known that she was through with the limitations placed on her by segregation. Although she never vocalized this, it was apparent that she was taking back what was rightfully hers, the freedom of choice. What she did not know is that her relocation was going to start an uproar in the town. Her relocation caused some of the town residents to send her threats of violence and caused some to start a petition to have her evicted. Charlie stood her ground against all the resistance she was facing. The townspeople quickly realized that Charlie O. Farris was not a force to mess with, and she was someone not willing to back down regardless of the obstacles in her way. Judge Sarah T. Hughes, most famous for swearing in President Lyndon B. Johnson aboard Air Force One after President Kennedy's assassination, came to Wichita Falls to further the integration process that Waldrop, the school superintendent, started. Upon her arrival, Judge Hughes went directly to Charlie's office. Charlie had the opportunity to give Judge Hughes a tour around the town and share her insight as to the progress of the schools. After the conversation with Charlie, Judge Hughes went to the school board to begin the integration process again. In an effort to ensure that the town did not abandon the plan to integrate after her visit, she created an oversight committee to see the process through and to report to her if they saw any resistance. Charlie, along with her secretary, Arthur B., were both members of the committee.
In 2000, Charlie O. Farris received the Award for Distinguished Lifetime Service from the National Association of Women Lawyers. The Distinguished Lifetime Service Award is presented by the President of the National Association of Women Lawyers as a special recognition for a person that has championed policies, programs, and procedures to retain, promote, and advance women lawyers. In 2003, Charlye O. Farris received the Gertrude E. Rush Award of the National Bar Association. The National Bar Association was created in 1925 when there were fewer than 1,000 black attorneys in the United States. The National Bar Association was created for black attorneys because they were not allowed to join the American Bar Association in 1925. Awardees of the Gertrude E. Rush Award must demonstrate leadership in the community and profession, demonstrate concern for human and civil rights, be a model for excellence in legal education, public policy, and social activism. In 2003, Charlye O. Farris received the Margaret Brent Women Lawyers of Achievement Award. The award celebrates the accomplishments of women lawyers who have excelled in their field and have paved the way to success for other women lawyers. To be eligible for the Margaret Brent Award, a nominee must have achieved professional excellence in her field, influenced other women to pursue legal careers, opened doors for women lawyers in job settings that historically were closed to them, and advanced opportunity for women within various areas of the profession. Charlie's response to receiving the award was memorable. Charlie delved into her personal feelings and said being the first black woman admitted to the Texas bar was an accident of birth. Charlie believed she was the first licensed black female attorney in Texas only because she was born before other black female attorneys who followed in her footsteps. In 2004, Charlye O. Farris received the Outstanding 50-Year Lawyer Award. The award recognizes lawyers whose practice spanned 50 years or more, who adhere to the highest principles and traditions of the legal profession and service to the public. Upon receiving the Outstanding 50-Year Lawyer Award, Charlie stated, "Having practiced for 50 years only means that I am an antique."
Charlye O. Farris attended Prairie View A&M, a historically black university in Texas. Prairie View, the first state-supported college in Texas for African Americans, was established during the Reconstruction period after the Civil War. At the time, colored Americans were prohibited from attending schools with whites. Separate but equal systems of education had been a part of the Constitution since the 1800s. Because of Jim Crow laws and other constraints placed on minorities, educational degrees were the safest avenues for women of color to pursue. Charlie's father wanted her to major in music and pursue a career as a music teacher, a profession she had no interest or experience in. Because of the discrimination faced by minorities, there were few occupations that provided stability for a black woman. During that time, common jobs for women included bank tellers, phone dispatchers, and teachers. However, Charlie had other aspirations that were considered rather risky. Her dream was to become a lawyer. She even asked her professors to help convince her parents to allow her to change her major. Her parents were initially apprehensive about the idea, but eventually gave in. She spent a year in Stamford, Texas, working as an elementary school teacher and quickly decided that the job was not for her. She begged her parents to allow her to attend law school and pursue her dream of becoming a lawyer. Her father reluctantly agreed. As was the current trend, many women were forgoing college and pursuing marriage at a higher rate. The women who were brave enough to go to college had to fight to receive an education that would benefit them in a society dominated by males. Lynn White, the president of Mills College, a nationally renowned liberal arts women's college, said that the curriculum for female students should prepare women to foster the intellectual and emotional life of her family and community. The educational system prepared women for a life in the home, recommending courses like interior decorating and personal finance. Charlie, along with others, were the first to believe that women could compete with males and succeeded in doing so. Charlie's father had one condition, and that was that she would attend the University of Denver School of Law, where Charlie quickly earned her seat. This was quite a feat, as it was very difficult for minorities and women to earn admission into law school. Also, men who were coming home from World War II were applying to law schools, making it even more competitive. Now, Charlie's father had hoped that her cousin, who was also a student at the University of Denver, would convince Charlie to return home and let her dream go. Charlie, however, stayed and ended her first year with poor grades. This was all very new for her. She grew up in a strict and structured household and was not used to being on her own, consequently neglecting her studies. Denver was also very different from Texas. Most of her classmates were white men. After doing horribly her first semester, she convinced her father to give her another chance and insisted that she would do better at an all-black law school. She applied to Howard University, which she felt had an environment better suited for her. Howard is known to some as the capstone of Negro education because of the critical role it played in the African American educational experience. Howard was created by an act of the United States Congress in 1867 and is the only historically black college or university to hold this distinction. 2 years after its founding, Howard established the first black law school in the country, where Charlotte Ray, a woman, was one of its first graduates. Ray was also the first woman admitted to the District of Columbia Bar. With this in mind, Charlie knew she had to buckle down and take school seriously if she wanted to achieve her dream of becoming a lawyer. She went to class, studied with peers, and made better grades. She also developed great relationships with her professor, which had a major impact on her success at Howard. During Charlie's final year at Howard, she met a man by the name of Ian Lincoln Crash Oliver. Her and Crash dated throughout the fall and spring semester and fell in love. In May of 1953, Crash and Charlie got engaged. Her parents came to her graduation and asked that she come back home for a couple of weeks to visit her family. She promised Crash that she would return soon and that she would write him every day that she was gone. Back home in Wichita Falls, Charlie's grandmother eagerly persuaded Charlie to stay in Texas and study for the bar exam, and Charlie did just as her grandmother asked. In the weeks before the bar exam, she received a letter from Crash that would undoubtedly change Charlie's life forever. The letter read, "By the time you read this, I will probably be married to the mother of my unborn child. In terms of what is morally correct, I am doing the right thing." Being the strong woman that she is, Charlie held herself together and finished her preparation for the bar. On October 13, 1950, Charlie's dad drove her to Austin, Texas to take the bar. Charlie was the only African-American female to take the exam that day. On November 1st, a newspaper article listed the names of the 92 candidates who passed the bar, Charlie being one of them. Her father drove her back down to Austin to be sworn in, and on November 12th of 1953, Charlie O. Farris became the first African-American female to become licensed to practice law in the state of Texas. Through all of the obstacles, Charlie persevered, accomplishing her lifelong dream of becoming a lawyer.
Charlie O. Farris's story reveals a woman who made a conscious choice to forego an exciting life away from the place where she grew up to become a solid pillar of her community, a wonderful friend, and a trailblazer who made life drastically better for so many people. Through sheer dint of her own personality, she caused a disparate group of people who would never have met each other to form friendships and alliances that made them better. I called her the glue that held us all together. We were all broadened socially for having known her and having fallen under her spell. I believe that if she had not succeeded when she returned home, the rest of the successful women in Wichita Falls would have had a harder time navigating the waters of professionalism. She took all the hard, sexist, racist abuses with grace and dignity, and thus spared us many an ordeal.